the tents over here in Israel. I don't know how much you're seeing, but they, it's terrible. It's a very, 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 very frightening situation. So I joined a brand new, we had a human rights movement, and we made it into a political party that's running in our Knesset in less than a month. And they're censoring us and attacking us, and they won't allow any media, nothing. They took away the head of the party's, his medical license, and they removed our platforms from Facebook, and now they won't let the media even write about us. So we want to ask all the international, anywhere we can get, to get to publicize what we are saying. It's a very bad situation here. They're not letting children as young as 16 to take their matriculation exams without taking this injection. They are, of course, insisting people for work. They're making this green passport where half the population cannot get into theaters or malls or all sorts of things unless they've taken the vaccination. They're creating a medical apartheid. They have now issued, just this morning, they made it that they're allowed to send each person's private medical records to the local municipality so that they'll know who's taken the injection or not. They're making people wear a ankle bracelet, security bracelet, when they come back from traveling. It's absolutely insane. It's absolutely insane. If I stop to think about it, I will cry, you know? But meantime, we just keep fighting, you know? Fighting as much as we can. So we need everybody's help, because whatever happens here will happen everywhere. Will happen everywhere. So we're fighting for ourselves, and we're fighting for the whole world. But we need help. We need every bit, everything. Every hand on deck. Yeah, thank you, Sika. Excuse me. It's intense, you know?
Ilana, Rachel, welcome in the Black Box studio. Yesterday I listened to a kind of a disruptive audio file from you all the way from Jerusalem. It gave me the goosebumps, and that's the reason why I wanted to talk to you directly to report from your side what is actually going on in Israel.
What's going on, in short, I don't know if there is a short version, but that our Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu has taken the initiative to sign us up without our informed consent to be the experimental subjects for Pfizer's rollout of their experimental technology. And they are doing so with just short of brute force, using coercive methods of threatening people with their livelihood, threatening young children, 16-year-old kids, that they can't take their matriculation exams. And the rollout of this has been very, while this plan is for many countries, in other places they give you the option to come and sign up, but here there's no option. You pretty much need to come and do it. It's already as if the science is settled, even though it doesn't even exist. And there's a profound governmental and social pressure already to rush into this this experiment. And and in Israel, they don't even speak about it as if it's an experiment. Well, the rest of the world is fully aware that's exactly what this is.
Are you saying that vaccines are mandatory in Israel right now?
Vaccines are not mandatory in Israel. However, this COVID-19 shot is, well, it's just short of it, meaning they say that it's not a have to and it's not a force. But the reality on the ground is people are losing their jobs if they're in the health, if they're doing any sort of health professional. There are many, many different places where people are told that you vaccinate or you're out.
You told me something before in this audio file about people wearing kind of a badge around their wrist, the free pass or something like that. What is that all about?
It's called the green passport. We're not told to wear it, but what they have done is they have essentially overnight created a second class citizenry, a true medical apartheid that is disallowing healthy, law-abiding, tax-paying citizens from entering their places of culture if they do not participate in this experiment. It's that simple. We've been told there are people who have been kicked out of their choirs, out of their pools, out of their gyms. Like I said, there's incredible social pressure and division between families, and this illusion of science that you're not participating in, so therefore you become this virus carrying threat to the rest of us, even though of course there's simply no existing safety studies. So it's really all in the name of science. They're actually doing something that's really just an illusion.
What is happening with people from abroad entering Israel, for example, by an airplane? What do they have to do to participate in society again?
So it's one of the worst displays of what's happening you'll see in the airport. I actually just this morning read someone's personal account of coming home, and his parent happened to have been a survivor, a Holocaust survivor, and he literally felt that he was in a selection. It was very clear. Those who have taken the shot or have recovered from the vaccine get to go to the left. Those who have not go to the other side and are forced into these filthy petri dish hotels that they have to either sit there, and they're all swabbed with this PCR test. And then there's also the option, again, the rules change from morning to night. So, but there is also apparently for some an option to wear an actual security ankle bracelet as if they're a prisoner in their own home. And you get to pay 2,000 shekels for the privilege of doing so. And this is what they're doing to their own citizens who have the audacity, I guess, to travel.
So what I understand is that the security wrist belt is actually a way of having a liberal quarantine at home.
Yeah, that's the liberal version. Correct. Correct. What we see here, and those of us in Israel, we understand that we are being used as a model for the rest of the world. And therefore, and because of the greater plans for this injection for the rest of the globe and for the greater plans that governments want to take these controls that they have overreached, these implementations that they've imposed on us, there's the feeling that it has to work. They're giving us no choice because we are the model in order to show everyone how fantastic this new version of life is. So we're up against extraordinary forces. We know how the bottomless wealth of the pharmaceutical companies, and we know the governments across the world. So, but this, the year of extreme implementations and policies, it's all culminating here in Israel right now with the rollout of this program. So like I said, while in other countries there's still a choice, here, the only reason they don't, in my opinion, the only reason they don't physically force it is because there would be too great of an outcry. But they're doing everything just short of it. It's the same old story. It's the other. It's this version as if, you know, it's the idea that this other is going to bring danger to my, you know, my safe place. And that's what those people who are not willing to participate in this experiment have become.
Is there any resistance in Israel to these events happening? I mean, if you look at it in a historical and also a religious perspective, you might say after what happened to the Jews through history and they finally have their promised land, it's kind of cynical what's happening now with the Jews in Israel.
You know, I don't know that it was planned from the outset to start here. I know that there are logical reasons why they rolled out this program here in Israel. But the particulars that we are, that our people went through the Holocaust, and you actually have some elderly people who have were Holocaust survivors now being tested on in their homeland, in our place of refuge, again, by the same company, only changed names. You really can't, you couldn't have tailor-made a more, a bigger betrayal, because the truth of the matter is this is supposed to be our refuge. And we are now front and center in a danger that nobody, no one can even define. We know the immediate health, we know many of the immediate health concerns, but the fertility issues, we have rolled out a program that, never mind the fact that the only group of people that was ever at risk of dying, with exception to this virus, who was 65 and older, and those with comorbidities, they put such a sense of fear that they rolled out this experimental program even into pregnant women, pressuring kids from age 16 and up, and women, pregnant women, literally radio messages, come and get vaccinated, you'll save your baby. You know, and the night before they roll out the program, it's this, for the first time in the year, they put out news articles that say, oh, we suddenly have 30 some critical women, pregnant women in critical conditions in the hospital. It's such a crude, obvious, and people buy it. They just seem to buy it. They seem to forget not only basic science, but everything, their experience themselves. The one saving grace in this whole virus was that the children are spared. And instead, we're pretending like a pregnant woman needs to go and take an mRNA technology into her system. I have lived in Israel for nearly 24 years, and I could never have imagined that we would do these things. I could never have imagined. And but the thing is that we know it's not a secret. There is a contract. There is an actual physical contract between Pfizer and our government. We've seen only a redacted version. What we know is there is a penalty clause. They must, right now, the government of Israel is acting incredibly desperately because they have some sort of quota of people they must reach, that they must inject. I don't know what this penalty clause entails. Obviously, it must be something more terrible than risking the health of and generation for generations to come of your entire people. But we know that exists, and we know that they're in a situation where they feel a lot of pressure, and so they're acting foolishly and more extremely. You know, they're sending out messages offering people a slice of pizza to get your injection. It's just a twilight zone. And what's even more painful is not only how extreme, because it's so obvious to anyone who is willing to admit, but that there's so many people that, for various reasons why that's true, but for so many people who still trust in our government and are pretending like any of this could still be about a virus. You know, we're being boiled alive in this pot and pretending it's not that hot. And it's very painful. These people we love and respect, our neighbors, our relatives, and we're still acting as if this is what's really going on.
Ilana, in the Netherlands, we're facing new elections very soon. And there is one politician who actually has a house in Israel. She's called Sigrid Kaag. And she worked for the United Nations, and she's actually setting Israel as an example. in the Netherlands and saying in the news that we should look at the success that Israel already has booked.
Laten we als Nederland een voorbeeld nemen aan Israël, waar gevaccineerde mensen weer toegang krijgen tot het maatschappelijk leven.
What would you like to say to her?
I would like to say to her that the data is not being collected. We are giving these people, these Israeli citizens, zero informed consent, zero ability to make a risk-benefit analysis. There is no opportunity for people to understand what they're signing up for. And not only that, what is happening is they are given an injection, sat for 15 minutes. 15 minutes and then sent on their way. There is no paper. There is no list of side effects to look out for. There is no number to call. The data is not being reported. There are a number of citizen efforts that have been made to record what our Ministry of Health is not recording. Only the most extreme things come into the news, and they've stopped that even. With the first cases of Bell's palsy, the first elderly people who dropped dead of heart failure within hours, and then the headlines changed the next day. Oh, there was no relation. There's no relation to the injection they got. I know people personally who work in medical facilities who watch 40-something-year-old people die of heart failure 2 days after an injection, and they're not allowed to say that it had anything to do with this vaccine. It's absolute madness. If you get shot in the head but you have test positive for COVID, you've died of COVID. But if you die of heart failure within 2 weeks, it has not, after getting the injection, it has no correlation. It's we're living in a dream world, and we deserve better. All of us deserve better. And it's not accurate. It's not scientific. And we know the whole idea of calling this a vaccine, even though we know that what it is actually an experimental gene treatment. The use of the word vaccine is to use that part of your brain that doesn't think at all, that only has this knee-jerk reaction. Because we know automatically vaccines are supposed to be safe and effective, checked for decades, you know, back and forth. It's this idea that people have. So they use this word vaccine, which never mind to mention the flaws in that narrative. But the one they're using now is so full of holes. It's insulting to have it shoved down any of our throats. And the point is that we know that any vaccine takes at least 10 years. And the idea that we have shoved this technology that has decades of issues. It never made it out of laboratory before. It never made it past animal trials. Ferrets, rabbits, cats, monkeys all died during animal trials. And now we're sticking it into the entire Israeli nation. It has never been tested out. The only time mRNA has been used is in the most extreme cases. None of the actual treatments that we've known about for the entire year have been given. And they haven't been given so that we can use this technology.
Let's get back to human rights. What is actually happening to the society in Israel? Do you still feel that you live in a free and open society?
No, absolutely not. I think that you hear people talking about, where can we go? People absolutely terrified for what will be from one day to the next, never mind for what will be in the future for our children. The divisions are so extreme, are so unreasonable. And I think that even people who have signed up and taken this injection are starting to see that because it is so extreme and the government is acting so desperately. But you know, right now, if you walk out without a mask, it's the same thing, stories that you hear about all over. You have people who are willing to scream at you in the street. And that's only a beginning. And they've succeeded in putting this narrative that you are a risk, a walking germ-filled risk if you walk into somebody's store without taking this injection, which of course has no opportunity to stop transmission. It's not what it was made to do.
I understood you're also running a political party in Israel. Are you succeeding?
So we are making incredible ground despite complete censorship. Despite, you know, they took off our Facebook pages of 60,000 people and they revoked the medical license of the head of our party. They are doing everything they can to delegitimize us. But of course, it doesn't succeed. It only makes them, it makes it more obvious that small parties in Israel have historically had a massive challenge. They won't even allow us to open a bank account to receive donations. They're doing everything they possibly can to keep us because we are coming against the only narrative that endangers them. These left-right answers, this doesn't matter to them. We are the only people standing up and saying this is unacceptable. This is absurd. This is unreasonable. You know, the Israeli people have sat in lockdown for a cumulative 5 months. 5 months of sitting in lockdown in our tiny apartments. Israel's a very small country. You know, we don't have big yards. We don't, like, it's absurd. Children with masks on, slumping in front of these endless Zoom calls. You really have a people that have been so debilitated that, yeah, you know, how many people the government says take this injection? So fine, it doesn't feel right, but okay, I'll go and do it. Because let me just get out of this already. They're telling me this is a solution. And even though my gut tells me it's not right, you know, how many people are going to take the extra steps to search it out? Not enough.
How do you picture the future for Israel in the nearby 4 or 5 years? What do you think is going to happen?
So I'll tell you, I find I have absolutely no idea. The future has never been more opaque. I think that's true for so many of us throughout the world right now. And I feel that, you know, not to be cliche, but a little light does expel a lot of darkness. And it's just one step. One step I take leads me to the next step, leads us to the next step. I don't know what's going to happen. Even these elections are supposed to happen March 23rd. That's a lifetime away in the world that we're living in right now. I don't know who's going to hear the message we're saying. I don't know what is going to become of it. I know that there is no other option than to give every fiber of energy and strength into battling this because there is no other option. There is everything to lose and everything to gain. I think it's actually never been simpler in some ways. And I believe that it's I believe quite simply that we are privileged to have this truth. If there is truth that I think is a common denominator against all these different people, different countries, different languages, and we all are seeing and speaking a very clear truth. And I think that truth is an absolute gift, but it's an obligation. And it wasn't given to us to just sit at home and with this apathy and hope for the best. We've got to all come together because really this is how we win. Making these connections between us, country after country, that is the only thing that these governments fear. They have the wealth of empires behind them. But when the people realize that we are the many and they are the small, they have nothing. They have nothing. And I can never give up on that hope that we're gonna build this force and take our lives back. Because I've said before, I feel like the ball is in the air. You know, it's like this volleyball, and it's a matter of who hits it. We're not going back. There is no going back. There's going forward, and we have a tremendous opportunity. And we have a tremendous opportunity to come together as humans. Without the questions of religion, they are pushing us so far that they are making this complete reset. We get to actually be just humans in such a beautiful way. As painful as these divisions that they've made, we actually can come together in a way that's how it's meant to be. That's my opinion.
Thank you, Ilana, for your bravery, for your honesty. I think that what you're saying is totally right, and it's very disturbing to hear what's going on in Israel, but we're seeing kind of the same things happening in Europe and in the Netherlands. And For me, it seems like a nightmare that we're still in, and I hope every day that we wake up from this terrible dream that it's not the truth, but it is. So I want to thank you for this call from Jerusalem. I've never talked to anybody from Jerusalem, from the Promised Land, and it shouldn't be like this. Thank you, Ilana.
Thank you, Flavio. Thank you.
Ja, dat was de prachtige Ilana Rachel uit Jeruzalem. Hopelijk gaat deze video viral buiten Nederland en kijkt er nu een internationaal publiek. So I'll end this video with a request. Share this video with as many people and thank you for watching.